An elemental outburst of protest and rage, not just against water charges, but against 6 years of unfairness, stealth taxes and cuts, much of which, the anger around much of which, centred on the cumulative impact, not just of direct taxation, but of indirect taxation and charges. And what I want to know, and I think if the government, as it says it is listening to what the people expressed on the streets at the weekend, are you going to do something about that?
Thank you.
About that cumulative impact of all of those things,
which
has driven so many people out on the streets at the weekend?
Thank you. Minister.
I'd like to thank the Deputy for his question. I can't call it. The period from 2008 to the present saw one of the largest and longest periods of fiscal adjustment in the history of the state. The budget deficit in 2011, when the government came to power, was unacceptably large and unsustainable at an underlying level of 8.6% of GDP. In budget 2015, I set a 2015 deficit target of 2.7% of GDP. Reflecting this progress in reducing the deficit, our debt burden is now firmly on the downward trajectory, with forecasts indicating it will fall below 100% of GDP after 2017. Reflecting these improvements, our credit rating has seen repeated upward revisions by rating agencies. A consolidation of such scale necessary resulted in a drop in living standards for all citizens in this country. Despite the enormous challenge of such an adjustment, the government has ensured that richest in society bore their fair share of the burden and that the poor and most vulnerable were protected as far as possible. The latest research from the SRI on the distributional impacts of budgets 2009 to 2015 shows that the top quintile bore the largest burden of income tax and welfare changes over the period, with income losses of approximately 13 to 14%. The impacts on those in lower quintiles were all in the region of 10%. This reflects the government's firm commitment to make sure that those who could afford to pay the most did so. Analysis published in the budget book shows gains to all household types from budget 2015. For example, the analysis shows that a single earner on an annual income of 25,000 will gain 174 euros per annum. A married one earner couple on 35,000 will gain also 174 euros, while a married one earner couple with two children on 55,000 will gain 626 euros per year. These gains reflect the government's commitment to helping those on lower and middle incomes. Analysis of the taxation measures in the budget based on the ESRI switch tax benefit model indicates that all household deciles will gain from the income tax measures in budget 2015. Some of these gains arise from the increase in the exemption thresholds for the USC, which had the effect of removing lower income people from liability to pay USC. The second time the government has done this. This means that all individuals with incomes below 12,012 euros will be entirely exempt from USC. The government also reduced the lower USC rates and increased their thresholds, delivering further benefits to those on lower incomes and ensuring fairness. At the same time, the benefits for any individual from the income tax package were capped by introducing a new higher rate of USC for high-income individuals, thus maintaining the progressivity of the system and ensuring that those on high incomes did not benefit over and above what is fair.
Thank you, Minister. The balance of your reply will appear in the official record.
Minister, I have to say that response really demonstrates how you just don't get it. You don't understand why people come out on the streets at the weekend. And I'll just throw your own figures back at you. Somebody earning 17,000, as you mentioned, got 173 euro back in the budget. Somebody earning 120,000 got 687 euro back in the budget, according to your budget document. Almost five times more than the poorest person or one of our people on the lowest incomes. Now, water charges, even if they are pitched at the figure Minister Burton mentioned yesterday of 200, which seems to already be causing great controversy in the government, but even if it were 200, which I doubt, that would wipe out, more than wipe out, what you've given back to the person on 17,000. But the person on 120,000 will more than be able to manage it. So how can you seriously say to me and, more importantly, to the people of this country that that is fair or progressive. And when you add into that the impact of rising bus fares, of electricity prices, of property taxes, of public service obligation, and all the other hidden taxes and charges that disproportionately hit the less well off, can you not understand that there is nothing progressive about the way you're managing taxes, and that it is tax justice is the issue that is at stake, and that you are not dealing with it in a fair way?
Thank you. Minister.
In reply to the Deputy, I'd like to make 3 points. First of all, as I said already, we've had the greatest fiscal adjustment in the history of the state. When we went into government at the start of 2011, the deficit was over 22 billion. At the end of next year, it'll be less than 5 if our budget comes in on target. So you can imagine an adjustment which takes your deficit down from 22 billion to around 5 billion, and you can see the level of the adjustment. Secondly, any of these debates, you can have a lot of anecdotes, but to really establish the position, it must be evidence-based. And the strongest piece of evidence is the ESRI's research. And the ESRI say that the people on the highest income quantile in society had the biggest adjustments in the nature of 13-14%, and other quantiles had an adjustment and a loss of income of about 10%. So the evidence contradicts what you're saying. There's another very fundamental fact about giving relief by reducing taxes in USC. Does that pay most? Obviously, there's greater scope for benefiting if tax rates come down, and those that pay very little tax, there isn't the same potential to benefit. For example, if you take your example of somebody on 17,000, they pay less than 600 a year on tax and USC. Someone on 70,000, where I capped it, pays just short of 25,000. So obviously, if the pool is 25,000 as against 600, well then the potential for when you adjust for higher gains obviously goes with the higher income.
Thank you. Deputy Barrett.
But Minister, see, this is the problem with statistics, and you know what they say about statistics. It just doesn't meet the human reality that people are facing, and that is what was expressed at the weekend. Can you respond to this? The OECD last week found that Ireland, out of 41 countries in the OECD, was the 37th worst. It was near the bottom of the league table in terms of child poverty since 2008. That child poverty had increased far more here than almost every other country in Europe, bar Latvia, Greece and Iceland. Okay, well, as other countries, even in the teeth of recession and adjustment, had actually improved the situation of child poverty, here we have gone from 18% child poverty to 28.6%.
Thank you.
Now, isn't that the clearest evidence that despite all the statistics you throw around, that the impact of the measures you've been bringing in recent years are disproportionately adverse to the lowest income people, and that is why people are on the streets expressing their rage, and that you have to listen, Minister.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, if we're to develop policy on an evidence basis, then all evidence is relevant. And what you quote needs to be taken into account by people forming policies as well. But the point I'm making is that the worst off people in society did not bear the sole burden. Everybody suffered because the level of adjustment necessary was enormous. It was unprecedented historically, and everybody suffered. Now, I've said previously the people that suffered most were the people who lost their jobs. And whether their previous income was high or low, the people who were out of work were the people who were most hit by the recession and the most at risk of going into poverty. The second group that suffered were people who were forced to immigrate. Not those who voluntarily immigrate, but who have jobs here, but the people who through economic circumstances, decide they have no choice but to go and seek employment elsewhere. And that's what we are trying to repair. but the repair job is going very well, thank God. We have the highest growth rates in Europe now. We have the highest level of job creation in Europe. We're eliminating our deficit. We'll have a balanced budget in a year or two, and things are going well. And then the repair job will continue. But, I mean, I'm not claiming that, you know, we have a finished article now. I'm saying we're well on the way to recovery, and, you know, we have to again start looking at society issues rather than at an economy, and we have to ask ourselves questions, what kind of country do we want to live in, and what kind of values are going to be in that company, in that country, and how do we look after the vulnerable? All those issues are valid policy issues now as the economy grows.
Thank you.